Today I'm going to speak to you about a topic that I've given the title, Dealing with Adversity. So it could be challenges or obstacles that we come across in life. We sang earlier on a song, the last song, it said, I can sing of the mercies of the Lord forever. I can testify of thy faithfulness. I don't know your story, but I tell you, I can sing of the mercies of the Lord forever because of what he has done in my life. Hallelujah! Amen. We serve a wonder-working God. Has it not been of the mercies of God? Has it not been of his goodness? Has it not been of his faithfulness? I don't know where I will be today. I don't know about you. I don't know where I will be. But today I can testify of the goodness of my Lord. Hallelujah. You know, sometimes we go through life. Challenges come our way. Obstacles come to discourage us, to bring setbacks. Sometimes things will seem like they're going on so well, and suddenly something comes to distract us, to challenge us. But I want to tell you today, I know of someone who can fight our battles. I know of someone who can break every chain. I know of someone who can heal. I tell you, there's power in the name of Jesus. We call him our Father. We call him Yahweh, the King of Kings. And there's no one like him. Fear not when adversity comes. Because God is still seated on his throne. Hallelujah! God is still seated on his throne. It doesn't matter what comes your way. He will see you through. How can we deal with adversity when it comes? I'm going to share with you a few stories from the Bible. But I'm going to share a few stories from my own personal experience. I'm going to illustrate what I'm talking about using the story of the Israelites. In Exodus 12, verse 31, Pharaoh summoned Moses and Aaron, and he said, uplift my people, you and the Israelites, go worship the Lord as you have requested. The Israelites who had spent years in captivity, their time to be set free had come. Exodus 14, verse 5. When the king of Egypt was told that the people had fled, Pharaoh and his officials changed their minds. They have just been set free. The Bible is saying the king and his people then changed their minds and they began to pursue them. They were on their way to the promised land, but their enemies started to pursue them. They were going to the promised land. As Pharaoh approached them, in Exodus 14, verse 10, the Bible says, the Israelites looked up, and there were the Egyptians marching after them. They were terrified, and they cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you brought us to the desert to die? What have you done to us by bringing us out of Egypt? Then he said to you in Egypt, leave us alone. Let us save the Egyptians. It would have been better for us to save the Egyptians than to die in the desert. Does that sound familiar? have you ever regretted? You know you've made the right decision, but something comes in to challenge you. As you are walking towards your purpose and your destiny, as you are walking towards your promise, something comes to distract you. Does that sound familiar? And now, God made a way for them. God split the sea, and the Israelites walked through on dry ground. Hallelujah! Listen, the Egyptians still followed them. Egyptians, Exodus 15, verse 19. When Pharaoh's horses, chariots, and horsemen went into the sea, the Lord brought the waters of the sea back over them. But the Israelites had walked through the sea on dry ground. That's what my God can do for you. He will cause the sea to be split so that you can walk through to your promised land. Hallelujah. And they began to sing a song of victory because they'd been delivered. But I tell you, didn't stop there. Now they're beginning to walk in the wilderness. For 3 days, the Bible says, they could not find water. I said they were walking towards their promise. They were walking towards their promised lands. They were walking in the will of God. But there were challenges in the way. They had been set free already from captivity. And God provided water for them. It didn't end there. They also waged war against their enemies, but they were still walking towards their promised land. They approached adversity in many various ways. I don't know how you deal with challenges. They were terrified. That's what the Bible says. They cried out to the Lord, the Bible tells us. And they also blamed Moses. They said, why did you bring us out of Egypt? How do you deal with adversity? At one point, when they were desperate for meat, in Exodus 16, verse 3, the Israelites said to them, if only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt, there we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death. Challenges are not uncommon to us. Like I said, at various points in life, challenges do come our way. Life's journey may at times be really difficult. Maybe you're in that situation right now as I speak today. I want to remind you of the one who is able. He is the way maker. He is our awesome God. He is the great I am. Hallelujah. The miracle maker. Think of the great things that he has already done in your life. He is the promise keeper. He is the light in the darkness. The one who can wipe away every tear. The one who can heal every broken heart. Our provider. God who is full of mercy. The God of love. Our strength. Our protector. Our security. I tell you, in the last 15 months, I faced challenges. I had an accident in January 2016. I tell you, it wasn't just an accident. The last 15 months, I tell you, I have suffered. In pain and with its own knock-on effects. I tell you, at times I was sleeping for just 2 hours. or 3 hours, or 4 hours. How I managed to carry on with life, I tell you, I don't have words to explain it. How God kept me with a sound mind, I don't even know how to explain it. But God is so faithful. The mercies of God endures forever. His love endures forever. You know, in the last 15 months, I've been on mission 3 times. Do you know sometimes I was going in a wheelchair? You might not even know it. Do you know for the last 15 months I've been going around with a cushion so I can sit down? I was not able to sit down because of pain. I only started to come to church without a cushion in the last 3 weeks. Maybe you didn't know. To wear a shoe like this, I started to wear a shoe like this 3 weeks ago. Yesterday, it was the first time I was able to wear a shoe which is a little bit high-heeled. You know, some people got me shoes just before the accident. You know, high-heeled shoes? I was just looking at them. I could not even think or dream of being ever able to wear them. But today, I can testify of the goodness of the Lord. He is God, our healer. Hallelujah. If he can do it for me, I tell you, he can do it for you. Hallelujah. Come July 2016, some of you know, but some of you don't know. My mom went to be with the Lord in her sleep, unexpectedly. January, I was involved in an accident. Come July, my mom went to be with the Lord in her sleep unexpectedly. I'd spoken to her 2 days before. And I didn't know I was speaking to her for the last time. Now, that came and that went. God saw me through it as well. Hallelujah! God helped me through that as well. Come November, December 2016, my job was put at risk. You know, I want to tell you, for the last 15 months, I've spent most of my life in standing. Believe it or not, I'll go to work and work in standing. I'm standing like this, the computer in the front of me, working like this. Believe it or not, I spent most of my 15 months, the last 15 months, in standing because I could not sit down. Going to bed, you know, now I can say I'm now going to sleep. Before, when I was saying I'm going to sleep, what I meant was I'm going to the bedroom. I only had one position that I could go into, and it's still the same. But when I get up, or I sleep for 2 hours, I could not go back to sleep because of pain. I was taking some of the strongest painkillers, some for the day and some for the night. They cause drowsiness. How God kept me. I would take them, I would wake up, I would go to work. I wasn't feeling drowsy. How that happened, I don't know how to explain it. But all I can say, my God was on my side. God was fighting the battle for me. I want to tell you, I had every reason to spend at least the last 12 months in bed and not go to work. I had every good reason. In fact, people were asking me why I was still working. They were asking me why I was going to work. In fact, because I'm telling you now, maybe you can understand what I'm talking about. When you saw me in the last 15 months, you didn't even have a clue of what I was going through. Because of what God did, or what God was doing in my life. Facing adversity. Facing the challenges of life. So most of the pain has been taken away. Hallelujah. I feel better. I'm still trusting God for total restoration. But whatever has been done so far, now I can sleep. Hallelujah. Now I can come to church without a cushion. Now I can travel. I can travel, not even bother about booking a wheelchair. Isn't that amazing? And that's happening here. Hallelujah. That's happening in this church. I had a breakthrough in this church. And what God did for me, He can do it for you. I wanted to tell you why all these things were happening. God was still seated on His throne. And I've seen even many great things happening in the last 15 months. While I was going through this adversity, I was also seeing God doing great and mighty things. Things that I would have never imagined could happen. But they were happening at the same time. Because God is God. Hallelujah. You know, when I came back from my mom's funeral, it's done a little bit different, you know, the way we do it here and the way we do it back home. So what we had to do, because we didn't know it was going to happen, my husband and myself, we were going to go to Kenya. So we had to take our money that was set aside for the trip to Kenya to go home and also support with the funeral costs. So we came back with no money. And people were speaking to me. They said, wow, you're almost ready to go to Kenya, you know. Little did they know that I didn't even have even a single pound. And people were talking, well, you're almost there, only a few weeks left, and we prepared, you know. I had booked annual leave to go to Kenya. And my husband is very happy for me to share this. You also booked annual leave to go to Kenya. We came back. And I thought, I am going to keep my annual leave. I'm going to act like I'm still going to Kenya. I'm going to prepare like I'm still going to Kenya. Though I knew that I didn't even have a single pound, I really knew what I'm talking about. And my husband came back. I'm sharing this so that you can also learn something, because he told me he has learned something. He came back, he canceled his annual leave because he didn't have money to go to Kenya. I didn't cancel my annual leave because I said, God, if you want me to go to Kenya, you are going to provide. And I kept walking like I was going to Kenya. I kept on talking like I was going to Kenya. I kept on preparing like I was going to Kenya. Yet I knew I didn't have the money. When my husband decided to cancel his annual leave, that's where his faith stopped. And I'm sure I'm encouraging somebody today. That's where his faith stopped about this trip to Kenya. And I said, God, if you want me to go, you will provide. You know what? God provided. Somebody came and said, Mary, I want to pay for your trip to Kenya. And not only did they pay for the airfares, they also gave me money to go and use in Kenya. Isn't that amazing? Hallelujah. So I went to Kenya. My husband didn't go to Kenya. Don't look at this and think that I'm not saying something good about my husband. He's very happy for me to share so we can all learn. The moment you decide that something is not going to happen and you stop trusting God, that's when it ends. So I went to Kenya. I thought I was going to be only speaking at crusades. You know, I love doing that. Casting out demons. Ha! I don't want to see demons. If I see demons, I cast them out. Something happens inside of me. It's like an anger. No, I'm not talking about bad anger. It's like I just want them to go. I just cast them out. Well, it's in the Bible, it says cast demons out, isn't it? Sometimes I think we complicate things. The Bible says, heal the sick, cast out demons, so I just see them and I cast them out. So anyway, I thought I was going to be casting out demons only, preaching at the crusades and everything. Little did I know. At this time, telling you of things that were happening during the time that I was not being able to sleep. You understand? I'm talking to you about things that were happening when I was taking some of the strongest painkillers you can ever imagine. And God was still on the throne. God was still doing great things and mighty things. And when I was in Kenya, that's where the door was opened for the TV program. Being in the right place, doing the right thing at the right time. Wow. It's now another story. We are busy recording. Last week, I spent 3 days downstairs recording for the TV program. I said, all these things were happening at the same time that I was facing adversity. At the same time, I was going through life challenges. God was still seated on the throne. God was still doing his great works. Here at church, so many things were still happening. Think about the Tuesday prayers. We were going deeper. I don't care whether I'd spend the whole prayer meeting in standing. I don't care. But I was right there in the midst of what God was doing. The pain did not stop me. Lack did not stop me. You understand? Let us not limit God. Because he is all powerful. He is great. He is awesome. We just need to make ourselves available. Let him do the rest. I tell you, you might be going through a hard time right now as I speak to you. I tell you, there's something you can do. You can't just sit there and hope that your situation will change. There's something you can do. I want to tell you about Esther. You know, Esther was a queen, chosen by the king himself. She was not just appointed by others. The king himself chose Esther to be the queen. But I tell you, there was a day that adversity came. And Esther was facing death along with the Jews. I want to tell you something. Esther did not sit there and say, you know what, I am the queen. Esther did something. When Haman had plotted death against the Jews, Esther had to do something. Esther gathered people to pray with her. Esther fasted for 3 days and prayed for 3 days. Esther had to approach the king. Esther said, if I perish, I perish. Esther had to take a risk. But that risk was not only going to save her. That risk was going to save the rest of the Jews. I tell you, you can't just sit there and hope that your situation will change. You need to rise up and do something. You need to rise up and pray. You need to rise up and stand. I tell you what, you might be the very person that God is going to use to bring a breakthrough for your family. And not you only your family, husband and wife and children. It could be the whole family line. You could be the one. Just like Esther decided that if she would perish, she would perish. She had to do something so that the lives of the Jews can be saved. Mordecai, Esther's uncle, had said to her, "For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place, and you and your father's family will perish." And who knows whether you have not attained loyalty for such a time as this? Who knows where you are in the position you are at this time? May we be attentive to hear the word of God. You know, the Bible says, "My sheep hear my voice." We need to know what God wants us to do at this time. In our life, in this church, and even in this nation. You can't just sit there and hope that your situation will change. There's something you can do. I said you can pray. Hallelujah. You can pray. You can choose to take a risk. You can fast. You can rise up. You can face the mountain. You can command the mountain to be moved. And it will be moved. You can trust in Him again. Maybe you've not been casting all your cares to Him. I tell you, you can do that. Instead of you carrying the burdens, I tell you, I know someone who can carry them for you. He has done it for me. He has carried my burdens. And He is faithful. And He can do it for you. That's my God, the King of Kings, the name that is above all other name. There's no one else like Him. Is there anything that is too hard for Him? That's my God. Hallelujah. As only if He did it for me, He can do it for you. Hallelujah. Are you trusting God for a breakthrough? Your breakthrough is coming. I said you can do something, hallelujah. There's something you can do. I want to tell you now about the four lepers and what they did. When there was famine in Samaria, there were four lepers. 2 Kings 7, verse 3. Now there were four men with lepers at the entrance of the city gate. They said to each other, "Why stay here until we die? If we say we will go to the city, the famine is there. And we will die. And if we stay here, we will die. So let's go over to the camp of the Arameans and surrender. If they spare us, we will live. If they kill us, then we will die." They had a few choices, these four lepers. Stay at the gate and die. Enter the city and die. Go to the camp. Maybe that option led a few probable possibilities. Maybe if the Romans felt sorry for them, they might probably have given them some food to eat. Who knows? But they said, "There you go anyway. If they die, they die. If their lives are spared, then their lives are spared." But I want to tell you today, they decided to do something. They didn't just sit there and wait for death to come. They decided to do something. When we move, God will do the rest. I said, the moment you decide to say, "This is it, this is where I'm stopping," I tell you, that's where it stops. They decided to do something. They began to ask themselves one of the very important questions that we need to ask ourselves. Why sit here until we die? Unfortunately, some people have never asked themselves this question similar to that. Maybe you can ask yourself a question. Why sit here and just hope that my circumstances will change? Why sit here and just hope something will happen? take risks. I want to encourage you to take risks. But obviously you need to hear God. I've taken so many risks. I've done so many things that people, when they hear, or when the people see me doing things, they ask me why I'm doing those things. Because in the human sense, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. Because when I look at it with human eyes, even myself, it looks like it's not possible. But I tell you, I decided to trust in God. And when I've taken risks, when I've done things that doesn't seem possible with human eyes, I've seen God moving. I've seen God moving the obstacles. I've seen God making the way. I've seen God providing. Hallelujah. I'm encouraging you to take risks. Don't just do it because it's making sense to do so. Don't just do it because you've got the money to do it. Because then it means we are not trusting God. Because we can do it ourselves. But when we are trusting God, we don't do it that way, do we? We put our hope in Him. We put our trust in Him. You know what? Wealth belongs to the King. Silver and gold belongs to Him. And He says, I shall supply all your needs according to His riches and glory. Hallelujah. That's my God. And that's your God too. Take risks. I want to tell you something that is very interesting. When the four lepers entered the camp of the Arameans, something happened. To me, it's astonishing to realize that that is what God can do. So the four lepers arrived. The Arameans, do you know what they heard? They heard the sound of chariots and horses and a great army. It was the four lepers, the despised of the society. It was four lepers who had arrived. But the Bible says, the Arameans, in fact it says, God caused the Arameans to hear the sound of horses and chariots and the great army. God caused. It wasn't the four lepers. It wasn't the idea of the four lepers to cause the Arameans to hear the chariots and the horses. The Bible says God caused the Arameans to hear the sound of horses and chariots and the great army. Do you know what they thought? They thought now they have now hired the Hittites. They have now hired the Egyptians. But it was the four lepers. It's because they decided to take a risk. And they started to walk towards the camp. As they were doing that, God did the rest. As you begin to walk, as you begin to take those steps of faith, as you begin to rise up and stand and pray, I tell you today, God will do the rest for you. Hallelujah. You can't just sit there and just hope your situation is going to change. I said, there's something you need to do. There's something you need to do. Hallelujah. Don't wait for the problem to overcome you. With God, all things are possible. God is not a man that you should lie. All He said and not fulfill it, that's not true. What He says you do, you will do. Matthew 19 verse 26, it says, with men it's impossible, but with God all things are possible. When we look at it with human eyes, it's not possible. But I want to tell you, with God all things are possible. God makes all things new. We sang earlier on today, didn't we? We said, I am no longer a slave. I am a child of God. I'm delivered from my enemies. You split the sea so I can walk right through it. You rescued me so I can stand and sing, I am a child of God. You know, for those who have not already realized, in the last 15 months, this is the first time I'm able to preach like this, to walk like this and preach like this. If you haven't realized, all the other times I've been preaching here, I was standing like this because it was not possible for me to be able to walk around. But thanks be to God who caused me to have this victory. Hallelujah! Woo! Glory! Hallelujah! You know, Ezekiel, when he was surrounded with dry bones, it was like the situation was hopeless. Wow! You know, God did something. I want to encourage you that through the challenges, you begin to see things the way God sees things. Don't let the circumstances pull you down. Ezekiel 37, when you've got time, you can read from verse 1 to 14. That's the whole story. It tells us about the valley of dry bones. In verse 3, it says, God asks, Son of man, can these bones live? Ezekiel replied, so the Lord, you alone know. I realize sometimes we come through life challenges and all we can say is, God, I really don't know where it's going to go. I've got no idea, I don't even know. But God, I trust you. Because only you, God, you know. This is the moment that Ezekiel was in. And he was asked by God to speak life to the dry bones. You can speak life to dry bones in your life. And they will come to life. When Jesus said it is finished on the cross, he made it. It is finished. We can stand on that truth. Jesus died, but I want to remind you today, he did not stay in the grave. The Bible says on the third day he rose again. And that same power that raised Jesus from the dead is at work in you today. Hallelujah. You can have your breakthrough. You can have your breakthrough. Hallelujah. You can have your breakthrough today. Hallelujah. That same power that raised Jesus Christ from the dead is at work today. And that's Romans 8 verse 11. Ezekiel said, dry bones, hear you the word of God. We've got to say something. I said, you can't just sit there and hope that your situation will change. You need to say something. Dry bones, hear you the word of God. Speak to the dry bones in your life. Verse 5 in Ezekiel 37 says, this is what the servant Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. This is God. I'm not saying you are the one who's going to make breath enter the dry bones. God will make breath enter the dry bones in your life. But you need to begin to say something. You need to begin to prophesy to every situation that you are facing right now in your life. I said you have to do something. You need to have an expectation. As Ezekiel was prophesying, the Bible tells us he started to hear a sound. He started to hear a rattling sound. He started to hear the bones coming together, bone to bone. Have an expectation. God is awesome. He sees hope. I said, begin to see things the way God sees things. He sees restoration. He sees breakthroughs. He sees healings. He sees miracles. The devil was defeated on the cross. I don't know what you see. Begin to see what God sees. In your situation, I don't know what you're seeing. Don't see defeat. See hope. See restoration. See the breakthrough. That's what God is saying. And that's what he wants to do. Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Hallelujah. I am going to move on now to sort of round up. But we do have time of ministry, and we are going to do that. I want to just tell you this little story about Paul and Silas. It's in the book of Acts, chapter 16. The Bible tells us that they were taken into prison, and they were put in the inner cell, and their feet were fastened to the stocks. You understand? They were taken into the inner cell with their feet fastened to the stocks. They began to do something. They started to sing. They started to pray. And the Bible says, as they were in the midst of praying and singing, God moved in a great way. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. There was violent shaking of the foundations. The chains were coming loose. Not only their chains, but even the chains of all the other prisoners. As there was a violent shaking, the chains were coming loose. When they began to sing and pray, I said, there was a shaking. And the chains were coming loose. My God is a chain breaker. Even right now in this place, chains will be made loose. I don't know what's holding you. I don't know what's holding you in captivity. But I tell you, as we begin to praise him, as we begin to sing, I tell you, we shall be singing soon. Minute, something will happen. As they began to pray, chains were made loose. And right now as I speak, it is my prayer. Whatever chain is holding you, I command it right now to be broken in Jesus' name. You may be hard-pressed, but I want to remind you, you are not crushed, perplexed, but you're not in despair. Could I kindly ask the praise and worship team to come? You may be persecuted, but you are not abandoned. You might be struck down, but you are not destroyed. That's from the Bible, 2 Corinthians 4 from verse 8. Do not lose heart. Though outwardly you look like you are wasting away, inwardly you are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an internal glory that far outweighs them all. So what do? We fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. What shall we say? If God is for us, who against us? What can separate us from the love of God? Will trouble separate us from the love of God? The Bible says no. Will hardships separate us from the love of God? The Bible says no. If God is for us, who can be against us? The Bible says in all these things, we are more than conquerors. Hallelujah. So be discouraged. Be encouraged. God is with you. Don't be discouraged. Be encouraged. Fear not, for God is with you. Hallelujah. I just want to pray. Soon we shall stand and sing, but I just want to pray for a few people here. Thank you, Jesus. Let us close our eyes. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just thank you that you are a God of wonders, that you are a God of miracles, you are a God of breakthroughs. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I just release the breakthroughs right now. I release healings right now. In the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, I pray for those who are standing facing the Red Sea right now, that you will make a way for them. I pray, oh God, the waymaker, that you will begin to make a way for them. In the mighty name of Jesus. I begin to prophesy right now to people's lives. I say to every dry bone situation that they are facing, I prophesy life to it right now. I say, yes, let breath enter that situation. In the mighty name of Jesus, hallelujah. For I thank you that those you have been speaking to about doing something, I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that they will begin to take the necessary steps, that those who need to rise up and pray, those who want to, you need to rise up and fast, that God, you will cause them, oh God, to rise up and do what they need to do. Those who will need to trust in you again. Those who need to hold on to the truth again. Those who need to see things the way you see things. I pray in the name of Jesus that you will cause them to do that again for your glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Right now, I just want to pray for those who have been carrying the burdens. You know, the Bible says in Psalm 55, cast your cares on the Lord, and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. I just want to pray. Just begin to say in your heart, if you know you've been carrying the burdens yourself, I just want you to start to pray in your heart. Just say to God, right now, I cast every care onto your hands. Father, I just pray for everyone who has done that right now, that God, in your greatness and your mercy, in your faithfulness, oh God, that indeed you will see them through. I just thank you because you said you shall turn their wailing into dancing. I just pray in the mighty name of Jesus that you will remove the sackcloth and you will clothe them with joy in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, Father. I just want to pray for the brokenhearted right now. I just pray according to the word in the book of Psalm 34. It says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. The righteous person may have many troubles, but the Lord delivers him from them all. He protects all his bones. Not one of them will be broken. Right now, in the mighty name of Jesus, every broken heart, I release healing. In the name of Jesus, I say, be healed. Be healed. Be made whole. Begin again to trust in the Lord. The Bible is saying, yes, you will deliver you. You may have many troubles, but you will deliver you from all of them. And I release that word to your situation right now. In the mighty name of Jesus, be delivered from every trouble. Be delivered from every challenge. In the mighty name of Jesus. I just want to pray for those people who can't see it yet. You know, Elisha was with his servant. Elisha was seeing something different from what the servant was seeing, but they were together in the same place. Elisha prayed to God. He said, open his eyes so that he can begin to see. I just want to pray for somebody here who can't see what I'm speaking about right now, that they are more for you than against you. I just want to pray for the revelation to come. Father, in the name of Jesus, I want to pray for everyone who is struggling to comprehend this word. I want to pray for them that God, you open their eyes so that they begin to see that there are more for them than against them. I pray, oh God, that they begin to perceive that you are well able to do it, oh God. You said with men it's not possible, but with you all things are possible. Lord, now I release this word to them. May there be revelation. May their eyes be opened, oh God, for your glory. In the mighty name of Jesus, open their eyes, oh God. Open their eyes, oh Father. I just thank you, oh God, that you will touch them. You will encourage them. I pray, God, no one will go home the same. You said in your word, when you send the word, it shall accomplish its purpose. Right now, I release that accomplishment in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Those who are trusting you for miracles, I release the miracles right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Those who are trusting you for provision, I release the provision right now. Those who are trusting you for healing, I pray, God Almighty, just like you did it for me, oh God, that you would do it for them. And indeed, they will see their miracle. Indeed, they will testify of your goodness, because you are such an awesome God, because you are such a great God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. I just want to thank you, because you are a miracle-working God, a promise keeper, God who is awesome, the God of wonders. I just thank you for what you have done in this place today. I just thank you that the enemy will not steal from us in the name of Jesus. And let God's people say, amen, amen.